afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. My topic is about 45 or 50 minutes. I'm going to go through imaging in diabetes mellitus, challenges and recent advances. Most of the work done in this hospital, Queen Elizabeth University Hospital in Glasgow. Some of the work is done at Diana Princess of Wales Hospital, where I used to work with Mr. Bazour. I have no disclosures, and the objectives of my talk is to define the challenges facing imaging and radiologic intervention of diabetic and obese patients, and to demonstrate how to overcome problems and challenges faced, to describe and interpret imaging findings in diabetic patients, with emphasis on cardiovascular events, liver and body fat, infections, and neurological events. And lastly, to discuss advances and future directions in imaging diabetic obese patients. So, magnitude of the problem. In a study in 2006, diabetes was estimated to affect 230 million worldwide, anticipated to reach 366 million by the year 2030. In a more recent study in 2015, diabetes now affects 415 million worldwide and anticipated to rise to 642 million by the year 2040. This number is underestimated because in Africa, more than two-thirds of the people with diabetes are undiagnosed. So these statistics are coming from the whole world except most of Africa. And if you look at the diabetes incidence, we find that China and India and then USA are the top countries. In the Middle East, we have Egypt is on the top of those countries affected by diabetes. In a more recent study, again, China, India, and US are on the top, and some other countries, again, Egypt is on the top of the Middle East countries. If you look at the UAE here, we found that 19.3% of the UAE population between the ages of 20 and 79 have type 2 diabetes, and over 1 million people living with diabetes in the UAE, placing the country on the 13th worldwide. And trends indicate that the prevalence of diabetes in the UAE is even rising at a faster rate than both in the Middle East and North Africa region and the rest of the world. Obesity is a major risk factor for developing type 2 diabetes. And worldwide, we have 2.2 billion people, like one-third of the whole world is overweight or obese. In England, 65% of people are overweight or obese. In the US, more than 33% of adults are obese. 80% of type 2 diabetics are overweight, and around 40% of type 2 diabetics are obese. So, of course, there is huge burden, significant morbidity and mortality, multiple organs, it affects multiple organs, and it involves all medical specialties. Diabetes is a leading cause of cardiovascular disease, end-stage renal disease, learning non-traumatic amputations. Obesity is associated with diabetes, cholelithiasis, coronary artery disease, hyperlipidemia, hypertension, osteoarthritis, and cancer. There is a strong association between obesity and colon and breast cancer, and recently there is a very strong association between obesity and hepatocellular carcinoma. So what are the challenges we face in the radiology department? First of all, imaging equipment. The obese patients are overweight, and the imaging equipment has its own limitations regarding weight and the gantry or aperture diameter. There's wear and tear, and of course there's a burden on the resources and economy. There are challenges in brain radiography, ultrasound, CT, and MRI because of weight. And some examples here we have, this is a normal weight patient, this is a chest x-ray, you see the lungs properly. Here, we constantly see the lower thirds of the lungs, and there's apparent modification of the heart, and difficult to interpret chest X-ray in these patients. Same thing in ultrasound. This is a normal individual. This is the liver diaphragm. Here, there is difficult appearance and difficult examination on ultrasound. In CT, the CT imaging systems of yesterday, the maximum weight was 160 kilograms. Now the CT systems of today can actually tolerate up to 300 kilograms patients, which is like 50 stones, if we talk English that way. And also the aperture between 70 now, the 80 centimeter apertures. Obesity crisis forces the National Health Service to buy 1 million pound supersized CT scanners to treat patients weighing up to 50 stones or 300 kilograms. This is a 57-year-old female diabetic, 145 kilograms, and you can see these lines running through the scan, and this white thing on the other side. These are called beam hardened artifacts, making interpretation difficult in these patients. In MRI, there is, I'm not going to go through physics, but there are strengths of the MRI machine. We have 1.5 Tesla, 3 Tesla, 7 Tesla. With the increased strength of the magnet, yes, you can see structures in a more proper way, but the fact the increased also magnitude of the magnet can lead to an artifact from some electric problem, and this artifact is called dielectric artifact, and this is common in 3 Tesla machines. If you look at this MRI, and this is the area of the pancreas, this area is very dark, and this is due to the dielectric artifact. And this is another thing here. You see this dark area here? This is before, this is on 3 Tesla scanner. And we have to get this sort of pad. It's called dielectric pad, which is expensive, in order to get rid of these dielectric currents. And then this is now disappearing. Another thing which can face us with big obese patients, particularly those with marked ascites. We have here severe ascites, and we have a very dark area here. So how to overcome this? This is 3 Tesla, and we can't really evaluate the pancreas properly because of this dark area here. So either to transfer the patient to another scanner with, instead of 3 Tesla, go to 1.5 Tesla, for example, or to try to reduce the size of the patient by aspirating the ascites. Right, another challenge we face is in fluoroscopy. Fluoroscopy is actually a real-time X-ray where we can actually do barium mean, barium swallow, barium enema. And again, the table has its limitations. 159 kilograms is the weight limit for any fluoroscopy machine. Maximum diameter is 45. You need additional ancillary stuff. And you have to train them how to carry patients, and some institutes have mechanical lifts in order to lift this very heavy patient. You may need to put tapes or straps around the patient for the patient not to fall down. And also, mechanically, put the middle or caudal part of the patient with the center of gravity in the middle or caudal part, and don't move the table. You have to move this X-ray source rather than the table model, not to get mechanical problems. The other challenge we face in nothing per mouth, many of the radiologic investigations are done when the patient is fasting, and because diabetic patients may have metformin or morning insulin, and you need actually the patient to be fasting. So the study has to be as early as possible in the morning. Type 2 diabetics, we hold oral hypoglycemic drugs in the morning and resume after eating. Type 1 diabetics or insulin-treated type 2 diabetics, we hold morning short-acting insulin. And blood glucose levels, particularly if the procedure is lengthy, like in interventional radiology, we check the blood glucose on arrival and every 1 to 2 hours during the procedure. Other challenges, like for example, if we're doing a barium meal, there is a timing of gastric intake and in diabetes, which affects all nerves in the body. So the parasympathetic nerves are also affected. We have something called diabetic gastropathy, where there is delayed gastric emptying or oral contrast, increased time of adequate bowel opacification. So it can be challenging. Another thing, if you're doing an ultrasound, and diabetic patients may have neurogenic bladder, so you have very thickened urinary bladder wall here, and this may get confused with cystitis, or you may actually get confused whether there is a tumor. And and also, if you want actually the patient to fill the bladder, some because of the neurogenic bladder, the country we hold for a long time. If you're going to do an interventional procedure and it's lengthy, then you have to catheterize the patient because they will have to go to the toilet every now and then. You can't remove the patients, and this will increase the risk of urinary tract infections. Another challenge is the contrast-induced nephrotoxicity. We give contrast in CT scans, for example, in order to look at the vessels and look at the organs with contrast. Contrast is risky to the kidneys, and the risks are more with pre-existing neuropathy, nephropathy, and with volume depletion. And the severity can be varies between mild, reversible rise in serum creatinine, or it can be disastrous with renal failure, necessitating hemodialysis. So preventive measures in order to overcome or to prevent contrast-induced nephrotoxicity is to hydrate the patient, give intravenous hydration, 0.9% saline before IV contrast. Some institutes prescribe N-acetylcysteine, 600 milligrams orally before and after the procedure. If you're doing digital subtraction angiography, you have to dilute the contrast up to 50% with saline. And in some institutions, if you're doing arteriography, don't use hydrated contrast, you can use carbon dioxide arteriography. Another problem are the type 2 diabetics taking metformin and the contrast-induced nephrotoxicity. The hydrated contrast is a potential concern for furthering renal damage in patients with acute kidney injury and in patients with severe chronic kidney disease, especially stage 4 and 5. So patients taking metformin are not at higher risk than other patients for contrast-induced nephrotoxicity. However, patients on metformin who develop acute kidney injury may be susceptible to the development of lactic acidosis. And so no reports of lactic acidosis following IV contrast in patients properly selected if we stop metformin before the exam and 48 hours afterwards. So I'm not going to go through this in detail. It's just, again, another challenge preparing patients taking contrast and taking metformin. We measure the EGFR routinely, and if the EGFR is less than 30, then it can be a problem, so we have to discontinue metformin and to be withheld for 48 hours after the procedure and reinstituted after checking. Another problem with metformin, there is a technique called PET CT scan, when you look for example, if there is a primary cancer, you want to look for other metastases in the body, do this PET CT scan. And the problem with patients taking metformin is that there is a marked increased activity within the colon. And if there is any lesion here, it will be obscured. So it is recommended to stop metformin 48 hours before doing a PET CT scan. And this is another example for 3 patients with cancer. See this high activity within the colon and the small bowel before discontinuation of metformin. And then after 2 days of stopping metformin and doing the PET CT scan, you can see now it's all clear and there's no abnormal activity in the colon. In this patient, there was a suspicious high activity here, stopped metformin for 2 days, and still this is very highly active, and colonoscopy was done, and this was proven to be adenocarcinoma. Not sure why it's not showing, but it showed an adenocarcinoma in this area. So the recommendation prior to PET CT scan is to discontinue metformin therapy for 2 days. Another problem in MRI, the contrast is not iodinated contrast, it's called gadolinium. And gadolinium, unfortunately, it used to be thought that it is a safe contrast medium. It is not really safe, and particularly in patients with kidney injury. It can lead to a debilitating skin condition. It's called nephrogenic systemic fibrosis. And if we test the eGFR of the patient, it is less than 30, or the patient is having an acute renal insufficiency, no gadolinium is contraindicated. So this is the first part of the topic, talked about the challenges faced in our radiology department in different things. Now we'll look at different disease entities happening in diabetic and obese patients, beginning with atherosclerosis. There is increased risk of atherosclerosis in diabetic patients. It comes earlier and it is more severe and diffuse. It affects coronary, cerebrovascular, peripheral arterial disease. There is increased cardiovascular rate, death rate by twofold in men and fourfold in women. Increased risk of intermittent claudication by 3.5-fold in women and 8.3-fold in women. Rapid progression of peripheral arterial disease in the presence of diabetes, involvement of the arteries below the knee, the tibial, peroneal arteries, and profound ephemeris. I'm going to show you a very challenging case that we faced. Also, atherosclerosis is more symmetric and multi-segmental, and stenotic lesions can be seen even in collateral vessels. This is Doppler ultrasonography or duplex Doppler ultrasound in so we measure the velocities of the blood flow and if there is a stenotic lesion, we can detect the stenotic lesion. We can measure the peak systolic velocity, the end-systolic velocity, and resistivity indices, and we can assess the degree of stenosis. But because of the calcium present in the arteries, we can see here calcific atherosclerotic plaque with acoustic shadowing, and this can be also a challenging thing during Doppler examination. In CT, calcium deposits in the vessels, and we mentioned that diabetes like the small vessels, like the coronary arteries and the below knee vessels. And you can see here, this is the fibula, this is the tibia. And we have here the peroneal artery, posterior tibia, anterior tibia arteries. And there is extensive calcification of the vessels. You can see how challenging, how can you tell what is patent and what is not patent with all these calcific changes happening in the vessels. And in MRI, you can see here, this patient, this is an MRA, this is the aorta, right, common iliac, external iliac. Is this an occlusion of the common iliac artery on the left or not? So this patient actually had no occlusion in this area, and it was a stent placed. And because of the artifacts coming from the stent, we saw this thing. However, on the other, on the distant part, this is the superficial femoral artery, which is absent, and these are the collaterals, bringing the flow of the artery, this total occlusion of the femoral artery, popliteal artery on the left side. Different versions of software, and some of the slide paragraphs are not seen here. They have used a more recent version. So here on the top, I'm talking about cardiac events. Okay, so cardiac events in diabetes. Type 2 diabetes is an independent risk factor for cardiac events. It's the leading cause of death in diabetic patients. And the problem, as we heard about cardiac physiology, there are some subclinical changes happening in the heart in diabetic patients, which can be seen by imaging. So I'm going to talk about here is the topic, cardiac, diabetic cardiomyopathy. I'm sorry about that, it's definitely here. Preclinical evaluation of diabetic cardiomyopathy is difficult because patients are usually asymptomatic. So patients are asymptomatic, type 2 diabetes, but there is diabetic cardiomyopathy. First thing uses cardiac MRI, which is non-invasive screening tool for assessment of subclinical detection of microscopic fibrotic substitution. There are some studies, this study was done in 2011, and looked at perfusion abnormalities within the heart, and this was found in diabetic patients. But more recently, looking at the fibers of the heart. So we have some epicardial fibers, subepicardial fibers, and fibers in between. Those subepicardial fibers run in left-handed helix direction. Those subepicardial fibers run in right-handed direction, and those in the middle are in the helical direction like that. And interestingly, when the heart pumps, there is like a squeezing motion happening to the heart. So those fibers at the base move at a clockwise direction for the myocardial fibers, which are the sub-epicardial fibers. And the opposite happens at apex. For the sub-endocardial fibers, actually what happens at the base is opposite, so counterclockwise, and here's clockwise. So it's like a squeezing motion of the heart. It's not just pumping like that. And this was proven in animal studies. This study was done in 2001 in dogs, canine hearts. And if you look at these lines, this is end diastole, this is end ejection, and this is mitral opening. And particularly look at the apex. So here, you can see the lines have moved down compared to the chest wall, and then there is a recoil in the relaxation time. So if we measure the actually the angle, which is the difference in contraction between the base and the apex, is called a recoil angle, or the untwisting angle, and then we can tell actually whether there is a problem in the contractility of the heart. And this was proven by MRI in 2001. So how to evaluate myocardial fibers is using MRI. First is something called here, it's not projecting, it's called C-gated sequences. It's the one like done in dogs, where this is an indirect one, whether there is abnormal contractility or not. And there is another study here, written in red, I mean, why it's not projecting. T1 inversion recovery sequence post-contrast. We give gadolinium, and 15 minutes after gadolinium, we do MRI of the heart, and then see the enhancement of the myocardium. If there is a focal enhancement within the pericardium, myocardium, this is fibrosis, and this indicates subclinical fibrotic substitution within the heart, which the patient could be. The ECG normal, patient is not complaining of anything, but you have detected a subclinical problem in the heart. Like this area here. So this is the enhancement within the myocardium. But in diabetic cardiomyopathy, the heart is involved completely. So if we have total enhancement, then you will not detect these focal fibrotic substitutions. This focal fibrosis is called myocardial scar. And this myocardial scar is a risk factor for poor prognosis in asymptomatic diabetic patients. However, is there any relationship between the coronary artery disease and myocardial scar? This was not known until this accredited study was performed, where they actually looked at the cardiac CT angiography and MRI of the heart in diabetic patients. And this was a prospective multi-center study having 347 patients with type 2 diabetes. And they did delayed MRI to look for this fibrotic substitution. And this saw whether there is any association between the presence of occult myocardial scar with the clinical parameters like age, gender, BMI, duration of diabetes, dyslipidemia, family history, smoking history, hemoglobin A1C level, and the coronary calcium score. So they found that there is strong association between occult myocardial scar on delayed MRI and significant coronary disease on CTA, even in asymptomatic patients. So this leads us to something we do, which is calcium, coronary calcium score, or coronary artery calcium score. It grades between zero, none, up to more than 1,000. And whether the main thing about coronary calcium score is that the grading predicts the risk of imminent coronary event. And it can encourage the patients to change their lifestyle and adherence to medication. But the problems as a screening test is that not all atherosclerotic plaques contain calcium. So you may have an atherosclerotic plaque, but it's not having calcium. And obstructive coronary artery disease is possible with calcium score of zero. And how often it should be repeated, and how long the reassurance of the score zero lasts. And it does not predict functional capacity or degree of stenosis. And that's why some people say, why should we do it? But it's a very good negative predictive test. Here on the top is written in red, myocardial mapping techniques. So like any tissue in the body, now like CT, we have Hounsfield units where you can see this is water, this is fat, this is calcium, this is bone. Every tissue in the body has a T1 value or T1 relaxation time. I'm not going to go through physics in this. So we can actually map the heart and get the T1 mapping. And at this level, 936 milliseconds, is the T1 value for the myocardium. And if this changes, we know that there is edema or fibrosis or storage disease or whatever. So this is a new thing for evaluating the myocardium. This study was done in Scotland. It's called the Scott Heart Trial. And the number of patients were around 4,000 patients, and divided the patients into two groups. One group is clinical care, ECG and clinical parameters and other things. And the other group, they added CT coronary angiography. So you do injection, just intravenous injection, and then get the patient to the CT and contrast chasing, get the coronary arteries and see them non-invasively, not through a catheter. And they found that in the group where coronary CT angiography was performed, and then afterwards they did the catheter angiography, they found that the normal angiographies were significantly less compared to the group where standard care alone was done. And myocardial infarction rate has reduced also in the group doing CT coronary angiography. And now it's a standard thing in patients who are getting standard cardiac care. You have to put CT coronary angiography with them in order to minimize the number of invasive catheter angiograms. So this was the result. This is the CT coronary angiogram, this is the catheter angiogram. So CT coronary angiography is used to guide patient management, clarifies the diagnosis of coronary disease, appropriate use of invasive angiography, fewer negative angiographies, and sharp reduction in myocardial infarctions. Next point is about the liver fat. So what is liver fat? It's called steatosis. In the past, it was called liver infiltration. This is a misnomer. It is not liver infiltration because the fat is within the hepatic cells. It's not between the cells. It's within the hepatocytes. And it's mainly triglycerides. So the proper term is steatosis rather than hepatic fat infiltration. Liver steatosis on the top in red is usually associated with obesity, type 2 diabetes, and hyperlipidemia. And regardless of the body mass index, the presence of type 2 diabetes significantly increases the risk and severity of non-alcoholic fatty liver. And it may contribute to the development of diabetes. So liver steatosis is not a benign condition. It can lead to non-alcoholic fatty liver disease, can lead to liver cirrhosis. It may reduce the efficacy of antiviral therapy. So in patients with hepatitis C, for example, getting antiviral treatment, if they're having fatty steatosis of the liver, it can be difficult to treat. And it may even accelerate disease progression. It reduces the hepatocellular functional reserve. So in patients, actually, if there is a donor and is having hepatosteatosis, it's difficult how to estimate the amount of liver is going to be transplanted. And the same thing, whether it can even lead to failure after transplantation if you just get a fatty liver to a transplanted patient. And the other thing which is important, it increases the risk of hepatocellular carcinoma. How to quantify liver steatosis? The gold standard is biopsy, but biopsy is an invasive procedure and is not representative of the whole liver as a whole. You just get a part of the liver and get a biopsy. Does it actually show the rest of the liver? No. And it's not without risks, and it may even lead, although rare, but it can be lethal. Hepatic ultrasound is widely used, but it is qualitative, it's not quantitative. You can actually see the liver, and in ultrasound, when you look at ultrasound, you see bright liver, so this is steatosis, this is fatty liver. But it is qualitative, it's not quantitative, and operator dependent, and inability to quantify hepatic fat content exactly. CT, you can actually look at the liver here, look at the screen, you can see the liver here is darker than the screen, and you can measure the Hounsfield value. Hounsfield is a British physicist who got a Nobel Prize for his achievement, where you can measure the density of the structure. You can say this is fat, or this is water, whatever. But again, it has errors due to iron, copper, glycogen, fibrosis, or edema, and again, low sensitivity in mild to moderate steatosis. Chemical shift MRI. Again, not through physics or chemistry, but you see water is H2O, and here the proton, which is the hydrogen, shares one electron here to the oxygen, another electron here to the oxygen, but in the unsaturated and saturated fat, there is only one hydrogen with oxygen compared to two hydrogens. So more magnetic field is experienced in water molecules compared to fat molecules. And this is the basis of an artifact in MRI called chemical shift an artifact. So for example, this cup of water and this is a tray containing fat, you get this crescent, black crescent and white crescent, where there is loss of signal, there is an additional signal due to the presence of water and fat adjacent to each other with different signal intensities in the field. Okay, I'll skip this one. So the basis of chemical shift MRI is here we do something called in-phase and out-phase imaging, and look at the liver here and the spleen, and liver and spleen. You can see the liver here is becoming darker on the out-of-phase sequence, so this is fatty liver, and there's no radiation, of course, more costly than MRI. The gold standard for estimating liver fat is MR spectroscopy, but again, it's not easy. Because it may have sampling errors, it needs expertise, it is not available in every hospital. This leads us to a technique called fat signal fraction maps. This is again recent. where you can actually estimate the amount of fat appropriately with this in-phase, out-of-phase sequence in the liver. But this is not as simple as this, because if you look at the fat spectrum, what we were talking about in the previous slide was about this peak, this water peak. But the fat spectrum is not simple. We have several peaks of fat, and you have to correct for those fat peaks in order to get correct ones. One of the applications is actually to do these protein density fat fraction techniques before and after treatment, and this is before treatment, and you can see that there is reduction of liver fat after treatment. Another challenge is actually the focal fatty change in the liver. In ultrasound, this is a patient with malignancy, 54-year-old woman with right upper quadrant pain and known malignancy. And you can see here there is focal hyperechoic lesion ultrasound. Is this a hemangioma? Is this focal fatty change? Is this a metastasis? We don't know. So doing CT, again, this is a low density lesion. Is this significant or not? Do in-phase and out-of-phase sequencing MRI. And you see the in-phase, and then it becomes dark on out-of-phase. So this is fat, and this is focal fatty change, no need for biopsy, and no need even for follow-up. Another, I got this from a paper, where this 39-year-old woman with lymphoma and malignant thymoma with local pleural recurrence treated with radiotherapy and chemotherapy and multiple small hyperechoic lesions within the liver. So looking at this could be lymphatic infiltration, lymphomatous infiltration of the liver. And again, in phase, out of phase, and out of phase, all these lesions become dark on out of phase sequence. And this is very unusual pattern of multifocal fatty infiltration or fatty change in the liver, multimodal hepatic steatosis. Exercise and diabetes. This was an interesting study done in Morocco, in Topal Mountain in Morocco, where they got 12 patients with type 2 diabetes, and they got 6 months moderate intensity exercise followed by a high altitude trekking expedition. And they measured the abdominal, epicardial, and paracardiac fat volume by MRI, cardiac function, hepatic myocardial and intramyocellular triglyceride by MRI spectroscopy. And there were some interesting thing. Here, the green ones here is the epicardial fat, this is the subcutaneous fat, this is the visceral fat. And the results of the 6 months exercise intervention in type 2 diabetes, there was significant reduction in the hepatic triglyceride content, significant reduction in the visceral fat and the paracardiac fat, which are the associated with increased cardiovascular risk. So definitely, exercise can reduce the risk factors, but it has no, it had no effect on the cardiac function. On the top here is written whole body fat and water MRI separation techniques. And this is another new thing, is to quantify fat and muscle in the body by a 6-minute MRI scan. So by 6 minutes, put the patient in the MRI scanner, you can actually quantify everything. Hepatic fat, subcutaneous fat, visceral fat, even the muscles can be evaluated properly. This is called detailed body composition. So this is a patient with insulin resistance, diabetic. You can actually do obese metabolic syndrome. You can actually have a body composition imaging. You have cardiovascular imaging. You have liver fat imaging in the same time in 6 minutes. The UK Biobank is the world's biggest body scanning project, and it's running right now. And I'm happy to be one of contributing in Glasgow here as a center in the UK Biobank. The participants are 500,000 people, ranging between 40 and 69. UK imaging centers all over the country, doing brain MRI, cardiac and body MRI, carotid ultrasound, and Alexa. Data are open to recognize the World Research Centers. So what they did is the one who were very active in research here in Europe is Sweden, where Advanced MR Analytics, or AMRA, in Sweden, plus one of the pharmaceutical companies, collaborated, and they got results, 700 subjects, part of the UK Biobank registry, and they studied the relationship of fat and muscle distribution by MRI in obesity-related conditions like diabetes, non-cholestatic hepatitis, and cardiovascular disease. And one of the interesting things here, we have a professor in genetics, and these are two female identical twins. So this is sister one, and this is sister two. And if you look at their BMI, you can find that both physically, from outside, phenotypically, they are exactly the same. BMI of sister two is 109, BMI of sister one is 94. So BMI, we think that probably sister two is more susceptible to cardiovascular events. But actually, looking by the MRI, looking at the exact distribution of fat, you can find that here, in sister one, liver fat is more, and visceral fat compared to subcutaneous fat here compared, more compared to here. So this sister one is having more risk to develop cardiovascular disease compared to this one, although she's having a less BMI. And the other interesting thing is to apply for this estimation of body fat is after bariatric surgery. After bariatric surgery, surgeons think that they make the patient better, and yes, phenotypically they are better, but are they less at risk of cardiovascular disease? Let us see the result. Yes, subcutaneous fat decreased. Yes, BMI decreased significantly. This is day one, this is 120. 1,000 years ago was the first to recognize the association between TB and diabetes. One third of the world population is latently infected with TB. And this is the map of TB and diabetes in the world. You can find dark areas here heavily affected by diabetes and TB. To skip these ones, are just, you know, fibrocystic changes in chest x-ray and CT, TB, this is biliary TB, this is TB meningitis, this is autoinfectory TB, autoinfectory with total calcification of the kidney, all these were diabetic patients. So TB can affect every part of the body. I'm going to look at neurological events. This was a 59-year-old woman with a 10-day history of involuntary movements of the right body. It's called right hemichorea, hemiballismus, poorly controlled type 2 diabetes, high blood glucose, and she had some right facial weakness, but no ketone bodies. CT was performed. There was no infarction. It just high density of the head of the caudate nucleus and the ventriform nucleus here in CT. I'm not sure whether it is projected well here because of the light, but you've got to believe me that there is, this is T1 weighted sequence, and there is increased signal of the caudate nucleus and the ventriform nucleus. There was no infarction in this patient, and this condition is called hyperglycemia induced hemichorea hemiballismus syndrome, or diabetic steatopathy. So there is affection of the caudate nuclei and the ventriform nuclei in diabetic patients. And the only thing, as I saw here, is CT hyperdense, MRI T1 hyperdense, but no diffusion restriction and no infarction. If recognized and sugar is controlled, these are reversible and the patient can go back to normal. Another condition which, if recognized, again, this could be a medical emergency. 57-year-old female, 10-day history of episodic clotting jerks on the right side of the face and the arm, and they thought that just convulsions. Carbamazepine was given, no improvement, and MRI was performed. and this was detected. There is some high signal intensity of the cortex and some diffusion restriction here, but subcortical white matter have a T2 hypointensity, and this is something which was not recognized before the era of MRI, and this is called non-ketotic hyperglycemic hyperosmolar syndrome, where if recognized, they just stop the anticonvulsive treatment, give intravenous insulin, and it can be, they can be reversible. If they think that this is just the convulsions, the patient may die from the hyperosmolarity and hyperosmolar syndrome. Lastly, we're going to talk about interventional radiology, and the and this is how challenging diabetic patients. So we treat peripheral artery disease, diabetic foot, coronary artery disease, and stroke by interventions, balloon angioplasty, and stents. Compared to surgery, interventional radiology has a shorter hospital stay, no general anesthesia, less pain, lower risk, shorter recovery time. And again, same problems in radiology and intervention have challenges with the table weight and with instruments targeting lesions. Look at this case, very large patient. We need to do a biopsy of the kidney and see the length of the needle needed to go all through this length in order to reach the kidney and get the sample. Again, in obese patients, this was a port, and you see the tip of the port here, but after the patient getting a CT scan and getting the hands up, you can see that there is coin here and the port has moved. So there is some variation in movement, in position of the tip. So we have to be careful. Again, this is a patient with either nephrosis, you want to do nephrostomy, see the subcutaneous fat, how big is this subcutaneous fat, how to reach this is extremely difficult. Bilateral nephrostomies were performed, but this was not functioning well on the right side. And then, given contrast, there is extravasation, so we had to remove this and put another one, and because of the movement of the catheter by the obese patient. This was a case report. I remember this, Mr. Suka was the surgeon at the time, who died in Princeton University Hospital. And this was a 45-year-old man, diabetic, ex-smoker, 5 months of progressively worsening severe leg pain and bilateral leg ulcers. And the surgeon at the time asked me to do whatever I do, because the other option is to amputate. There's no other option. And you can see here the severe affection. This is the popliteal artery occluded. Severe stenotic lesions here of the femoral artery. Femoral artery is occluded. Reconstitution of the popliteal by these collaterals. And again, some stenotic areas here of the posterior tibial peroneal and anterior arteries. So what I did is first to dilate the tap from above. We dilated the superficial femoral artery. And then tried to go down in order to save the patient's leg, but a complication happened, which is reported in the coronary interventions. Never happened in the peripheral interventions before, is this tiny guide wire got lost within the peroneal artery. So you're stuck now with occluded peroneal artery. What do you do? 5 p.m. in the district hospital, and the other option is actually for the patient to get amputated. So what I thought is actually to try to get a stent to push this guide wire on the wall of the artery and then get the patient pulling back, and this is what we succeeded to do. So this is the guide wire pushed to the wall, and the stent is beside it, and now the flow all the way down. And this was published in Liverpool in 2014. Finally, interventional radiology in type 1 diabetes is the allogenic pancreatic islet cell transplantation. So is actually still under research. The donor is a dead or brain dead person. Pancreas is removed, islet cells isolated and prepared, and then sedation, local anesthesia, IV antibiotics. And then the technique is by the interventional radiologist percutaneously to get into the portal vein here, and then to inject these islet cells within the portal vein. And it was found it was successful, but patients may require more than one islet cell infusion over several months before they are able to stop insulin injections. Criteria for optimal patient selection are not yet determined. It may be particularly indicated in patients with recurrent severe hypoglycemia. Finally, political thing, the previous councillor of the Exchequer of the United Kingdom actually put sugar tax, where when you want to buy a chocolate bar or something, then you pay more because this is tax. And they claim that they will get £520 million from impacting this sugar tax. It's not in power anymore. You can see these packages now in the supermarkets that, for example, half of this pizza provides this amount of calories and total amount of sugar. But these are confusing to the normal person. If I go to the supermarket and find this is 617 calories, what does this mean? So now the packages are, say, if you want to drink this can, you're going to spend 41 minutes of walking, for example, in order to burn this can. Or, for example, 24 minutes if you eat this part of a chocolate bar or biscuit. So instead of putting calories, they put how many minutes of walking or. So walk and bike are important for diabetes. Being a radiologist, not for me, because I'm also an interventional radiologist, so I stand and walk, but many of the radiologists' job is to sit and report. So this is sedentary life. This is actually a reporting radiologist station, PACS workstation in Norway, in hospital in Norway, where they put the treadmill while and the radiologist actually reports while we are walking on the treadmill. And this is true. This is not fancy. This is true in Norway. And also this is doing some exercise in between reports. Because they found that radiologists are at higher risk of development of cardiovascular disease and diabetes and obesity compared to other professionals. So in summary, and I'm sorry if I was a bit lengthy, I talked about the challenges faced in the radiology department for diabetic patients and obese patients. Particular emphasis on cardiovascular events, body fat, infections, and neurological events. And I talked a bit about interventional radiology. These are my references. And this is the hospital where I'm working. And thank you very much.
So, wonderful talk. Fascinating. So you did. You did a fascinating job to present.
Thank you.
The challenges and the new methodology you are trying to use to overcome those challenges. I have two questions. One is, when you trying to use CT on like obese people, do you need to increase the exposure?
Yes. This is a very good question, yes. The bigger the patient, you need more milliampere and kilo voltage, and then you have to specify certain parameters, and the exposure is definitely high in obese patients compared to normal patients. Yes, definitely. Yes.
Okay. A second question is, you talk a little bit about trying to help people to have more exercise, at work. So in the U.S., what now is very popular is that high-end like working desk.
I
don't know whether that you have that in the UK.
Yeah, we do. We do in the PACS workstations.
Yeah.
Room. Instead of having a table and a chair and sit, the table actually moves up all the way, so it can report while standing. And it was found that you burn calories while you're standing compared to being sitting. I like to report while sitting, but some of my colleagues report the 4 hours while standing and walking and moving their legs, so that to not to be
sedentary. It's also gotten popular in the US, and then National Institute of Occupational Safety and Health is thinking about doing a study to evaluate the health benefit of that standing working desk.
This is true.
You know, I have that in my office, so several of my co-workers also have that. So, you know, I think you did a fabulous job talking about all different issues, and then, you know, relate to that radiology imaging work. This is outstanding. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Very nice presentation.
Thank you.
I would like to know about when you see, when one of your slides said about the weight of the patients, like kilos over that. When you see a patient weighing so much and with severe diabetes and also in a very bad shape, do you think they really have another option outside bariatrics come down? Because when you say exercise, do you think they can do, you know, because their heart is not in a position to take exercise as well?
Well, it's not from my own experience, it's the experience done in this talk, in the experiment done in Toubkal Mountain in Morocco, where 6 months exercise significantly, from the statistics point of view, significantly reduces the amount of liver fat, visceral fat, and endocardial pelvic fat, which are all associated with cardiovascular risks and cerebrovascular accidents. It did not decrease much of the subcutaneous fat, which is the phenotypic appearance, but apparently the subcutaneous fat is not the risky thing compared to the other organ fat. Bariatric surgery may reduce, and it's successful in reduction of the BMI, but according to this paper, it did not decrease significantly the liver fat, visceral fat, or the epicardial and endocardial fat. So based on these two papers, I would say exercise